Okay, welcome everyone to this course this week. My name is Bright, and I can see a sign that several of you have attended this course before. So I see you have started already doing the right thing this morning. So I welcome you from Angola to Cape Verde, from Egypt to Nigeria, from Ghana to Rwanda, from South Africa to Zambia, Malawi, wherever you're joining from. This is the African Science Frontiers Initiatives, the art of scientific writing. As usual, I think this is going to be a fantastic week for all of us. So get ready. We will give you many troubles this week, but they are good troubles that will help us to see how we can do better what we are doing in our scientific career. Please feel free, this introduction, if you want to open your camera, we match your face to your name. Otherwise, once we start, it's a marathon. Give us your nice smiles. Welcome, Africa. Great. We still have many people still joining. Yes, great. This week may be challenging for me. My kids just got COVID, so we're all exposed. So those who pray for me so that I will continue to the end. I know everything will be okay. So if anything happens, just let you know that I'm trying to sort things around here. All right. Okay. This is me, and I have my colleague Eman, who is working with me in the ASFI family. Eman, can you say some words before we kickstart? Eman, you're muted.
Hello, welcome everyone. I hope you all of you will enjoy this interesting course. Please keep in touch for discussions and continue working with all the ASY family. The course will be a great step in your future and in your academic career. Hoping you all enjoy. Thank you.
All right, thanks very much, Eman, for that. You are a few of those that were selected for this course. We got very huge number of people. As you saw in my email, 671 people applied. So we had to, of course, we can't carry everybody. That is how it works. So please ensure that you make very good use of this opportunity. There's always a big challenge and temptation when you are joining online like this, many other things coming around to you to distract. So please do your best to see how you can minimize and make use of this. Many, even as I'm speaking now, many are already writing me asking, oh, why am I not taking, and so on and so forth. So you have been taken. Some of you were so angry that you are not taken that you almost took him to court. So I had to raise my two hands answering that. So it shows how much value you're putting on this. to see how you can improve yourself. We appreciate that. So when you get angry, we are not angry. We know what it is. I'll feel the same when I'm looking forward to be selected, and then I get this very discouraging email that you have not been selected. So some of you wrote me that you were praying and fasting and your prayers were answered. That's good. All right. Any quick thought from you, any observations this far before we kick off? Anything, please just speak. I'm replying to some emails here, some who have lost their way on taking the bus to come here to ASFI writing course. They have lost their way. So let me just give them direction how to go. So many things happen Monday mornings and before we start like this. I hope everybody gets themselves in order. Yeah, so please, people are already using the chat box. Please introduce yourself. Tell us who you are. Tell us why you're here. Tell us why you're excited to be here.
Hello. Hello.
Hello. Who's speaking?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, so I'm Rebecca Omedubaba.
Oh, the Rebecca. Rebecca, the one that almost took me to the court.
Exactly.
Yeah. Welcome, Rebecca.
I'm bent on learning and then getting more experience.
I'm from Ghana. Yeah, I see that.
Exactly. Despite I'm at work, we've not started work. My consultant is not yet in. So when he comes, I will still be listening to whatever it is, whatever comment, I'll just place it on the chat box. And thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to be part of this program. I'm very grateful.
It's okay. You're welcome, Rebecca.
Thank you.
My daughter, I told her that somebody wants to take me to court, and she was so angry yesterday. She said, "Daddy, how would they take you to court?"
Oh, dear.
All right. Okay. So yeah, any other thoughts? Any other thoughts before we kick off? So one thing is that as a point of housekeeping, we try, even though it's going to be an intensive week, we try to make it relaxing so that you learn in an atmosphere of joy, meeting colleagues from every part of Africa. So please make use of that. Since we started last year, there have been tremendous connections people have made. People have established lifelong collaborators in their different areas of research, friendship, and so on and so forth. So make use of that. I have shared group activities, group pairing, group projects, get into it, make friends, collaborate, and discuss. All right. And so please, as you join, this is recorded particularly for the sake of those who have not been able to join here, so that they can also share into what we are doing here. So if you're not speaking, just mute yourself so that we minimize background noise. All right. So I will kick off. So this is African Science Frontiers Initiatives course. This is one of the courses in the series of courses we run. We have done several already in the past over 1 year, almost 1.5 years. Now, we started last year, July, around some one of those we have repeated. And hopefully, we may run this second edition of the reproducibility course in scientific research. January, we did it last year, so we hope to run it again this coming January, all things being equal. But just look forward to that. We'll come back to that. Okay, this is about myself. I'm an associate professor of epidemiology here in Sweden at the Institute of Medicine, University of Gothenburg. My research areas, the research in allergy, respiratory disease, maternal child health, respiratory diseases. I've now also included COVID into the framework of what I do, and the diverse other areas I do as an epidemiologist. My perspectives usually are broad. I teach courses in epidemiology, data science, reproducibility in science, scientific research, research grant writing, academic publishing and writing, as you see here, and of course, evidence synthesis. So those of you who have been attending our courses, you can already see that from the panel of courses we have been offering. So please, if you are not speaking, just mute yourself so that we avoid the noise. All right, so as I mentioned, use the chat box to introduce yourselves, and so that we can get used to who you are. And of course, you can make detailed introductions when you meet in your different group breakout sessions. Before we go into the course proper, just to lay background why we see what we are seeing here today. Why why we are here as ASFI, as we choose to call ourselves, and why we are doing what we are doing. Okay. As you know, our continent Africa is lagging behind in almost every indicator of development. That is a clear fact, and we have to accept it with sincerity. So, apart from the only place I think we are winning other regions is the booming population we have. Okay, but that it itself is a frightening scenario, because if you have such rapid growth in the population of a nation without the basic facilities to take care of them, then it's really catastrophic that may happen in a little while. So within the African Science Frontiers Initiatives, our core conviction is that there can be no meaningful societal development without science. It has not happened anywhere. And that is on the fact that God created us and put us here and has given us the ability to use what he has created within the environment and to help to develop ourselves. Please, if you're not speaking, mention again, mute yourself so that we minimize the noise, please. And so science is important and crucial for any societal development. That is clear. But it's not just science. It's also a thriving science. A thriving science needs to be in place. So this is the problem we face when we are organizing things like this. People fail always to take very simple instructions. Complete your acceptance form, and then when instructions are given, read it to the details. So people still keep bothering me. Where is the link to the course? Where is the link to the course? So some have not completed the acceptance form, and automatically they are knocked out of the way. And then those who have accepted and they completed the acceptance form, receiving the emails, do not read it carefully to follow the instructions that have been given. So this is very, very important, especially when you're dealing with huge amount of people like this, then it's really difficult, almost impossible to attend to each person's needs. Okay, so please, there will be many instructions during the course here. Put your diligence, pay attention to ensure that you get them and follow them. And by that, we will be able to benefit in the right way from this course. So the point I was making is that there can be no meaningful societal development without science. And the science, of course, needs to be thriving. It needs to be fruitful. It needs to be seen. It needs to address the questions that are relevant in that environment. That is how man has developed until this time. And we have to use our God-given strength and wisdom to make this happen. And we need to develop ourselves. We need to improve from the stone to light the fire, to developing the matches we use to the lighter. These are developments that are happening, and they happen in the society. We need to continue to fine tune that. And science is the place that allows us to do that, at least to try. But science cannot thrive without the right competencies, cannot thrive without the capacity of the scientists being built. It cannot thrive without the right skills being made. So please, this is our core motivation. For our dear continent, we believe that it's too long we rely on the politicians to work miracles. And then we keep relying. But really, as scientists, we forget that the power we talk about lies in our hands. The power that we talk about lies in our hands. And you can see that manifesting in the issue of this COVID. Africa was and remains the baby that is spoon-fed, the baby that is spoon-fed. Why? Well, that is a million and one question. Are you playing your role? Are you playing your role? Are you playing your role properly? If you are not, what is the issue? And one of the things we have discovered is that the capacity and competencies of many African scientists needs to be built. And you can see that with the reflection of announcing a course like this, you get 691 people across the continent. That is a sign that there is room for improvement. That is a sign there is room for the hunger of doing things in the right way. That is a sign that there is room to improve, to compete with other people across the world. It's not the largest number we have had. Last time we had, it was 950 people that applied. So these are good signs for us, but at the same time, it showcases that we have to do things and do things well. And that is the gap we try to fill here at the African Science Frontier. So we start value-oriented scientific research, which is well-intentioned, which has vision to solve problems. No nation can be built. No nation can be built. So, value-oriented scientific research, well-intentioned, visionary, targeting problems. Without it, no nation can be built. I don't know if any of you wants to really contest this. I don't know if you want to contest it. If you want to contest it, just raise your hand. I will recognize you and we can discuss it. But otherwise, you can also as well give me a thumbs up for that, because I think that is a clear fact that is there. So what is the vision of the African Science Frontiers Initiatives? Our vision is to raise the next generation of African scientists who have the right competencies to drive Africa's developmental and transformational agenda through innovative scientific research. That is what we want to get out of you. And really, as you have come here, don't think this is a tea party. This is really a serious thing we are going to do this week. And we are going to push you to the wall. Push you to the wall. And when you're pushed to the wall, you realize that by the time you leave this week, there are questions you will ask yourself. There are mind searching that you will go through. And of course, I believe that with all our efforts put together, we are going to leave with satisfaction, smiling to know that I have learned something to add to what I know. And as here, I am not going to really teach you. As you know from our previous courses, we empower you to self-explore. So giving you the tools, my way of teaching is I put the burden of learning on the participants. I put the burden of learning on the participants. Through that, you go through self-discovery that changes perspective. I call it transformational education. And I think that is what we need to get things happening. All right, so our mission is to instill excellence. And with excellence, we mean it. Excellence in African science through competence acquisition, capacity building, and career development. We want to contribute to African science that tackles Africa's developmental challenges, as we believe that only a competent science can change our current narratives. Okay, that's our maxim. And so what do? We have several activities. We're already running since last year, and some of those are also in the pipeline we are organizing that will kick off in 2022. So we have seminars. We coordinate through the seminars conversations on African science and linking it to Africa's developmental needs and emphasizing the fact that African science is a place that needs to proffer the solution for Africa's developmental needs. we organize hands-on courses like this one now you have, courses around scientific research methods, capacity building, career development, science leadership, science communication. We also have mentoring, program. At the end of each course, we establish a mentoring cohort, okay? Last year, we established a cohort that has been there. They've published one paper together, and now they are working on two papers, okay? So it's a continuous, they have been there for more than 1 year, and they are working, meeting every month to discuss their project and milestones. And then we finish one in January, we set up a mentoring cohort. We finish one in May, we have established a mentoring cohort. We finish one in July. So altogether, I think we have close to more than 150 people who are in our mentoring program. And I hope that at the end of this course this week, we can also establish a mentoring cohort for scientific writing. Okay, we also have research arm. We're organizing survey now. We want to work on around these areas on the topics you have either treated in our courses or seminars on research funding and the university industry partnership in Africa. Through these courses, we target minimum of those who have master's degree, okay? Senior and junior academicians. The overall goal is that by targeting these people, our goal, we trickle down. The skills people learn, we trickle down. Because these people are teaching people, working with people. So with this, they can also go back and share the experiences they have gained from this course. All right, so you can see that this is also important to select those who really will benefit from this, given the number of people that apply. Really, the online platform we use here, you can see it has been quite helpful in the sense that it can accommodate many people from many countries at the same time. Otherwise, then we need to find a venue where people will travel, cause calls, and different kinds of logistic challenges along the way. And if we have it online, there are at least 85 of you who fully accepted to be on this course this week. It is really challenging to bring all of them in one place if it's a physical meeting. So other courses we have, reproducibility in scientific research that I mentioned, we'll plan to repeat that again in January. We have research funding and grant writing that we repeat that. We had it this year, we repeat it in May. Next year, our systematic reviews and meta-analysis that we had in July this year, we'll have it at the same time. And that was the first course we started last year. And the thing is that we set out a three-year plan. So the systematic reviews, and this three-year plan is the period we are going to offer free courses to Africans, scientists. So by the time we have the systematic reviews and meta-analysis course next July, we have completed the 3 years of free offering of that course. What happens next? We'll think about that. But that is our plan, and I am sure you are happy that we have that plan, really. You say, oh, but how will, yeah. We are doing our own part and doing our best. So of course, we will see what happens. Our goal is to see how, if we can get funding to continue to offer this free of charge, no problem, we'll do that. So if you know where we can get funding to support the organization of these programs, we are happy to explore that. And of course, this will continue to be free. Otherwise, we'll see how we can support those who are in the background organizing this, putting everything together. It's not easy organization, as you can observe. And then we have the Frontier Seminar Series that has been going on 2021. The last edition of it will be coming on the 19th of December, next Sunday. Next Sunday now is coming. And if you have not attended that before, this seminar series, please watch out for it. Today, I think the registration will open. And then you get information about that. It is good. We have started this since January, running it after every 3 weeks, and it has been a wonderful experience. Different topics have been treated, different topics. I can't begin to name them now, but I think we have covered many things that really bother and are of concern to many scientists. So what is coming on Sunday is focusing on the role of non-governmental organizations and charities in scientific research in Africa. What is the role they are playing? The last one we had was on the role of the government on scientific research in Africa. So please make yourself available. From January 2022, we continue the seminar series, but we are going to actually change direction of what next year we are planning the series will be on showcasing cutting edge research that people are doing across Africa. Cutting edge research that people are doing across Africa. Okay, so try to be part of that. I think we will all be happy with how this goes. So some of you who have attended before already have renamed yourself. So please rename yourself by adding your group. Rename yourself by adding your group to your name. It makes it easier for us to assign you to your group. So it makes it easier for us to assign you to your group. So this is how you rename it. Add your group there. If you just see your picture on Zoom, go to the top right of it. There are three dots there, I think. There are three or four. Click it, and then down part of it, or after the middle of it, you will see rename. Then you add your group there. Please do this. You are so many of you here, over 80 of you who finally joined this course, some still on their way. It means that assigning you to your group will take us lots of time that we do not have. So please do your best. Certificate of attendance, people are asking that question. we'll issue that as we have done, but this is only to those who faithfully complete the course. So I have assigned everyone to the groups and I'm going to, as we have done in the past, make assessment about participation based on the group work. Make assessment. So the group coordinators, one of the key things you would do is that please take attendance, and not just attendance. Some people may just put on their computer there, but they are not there. Make sure people are there, people are contributing, and then before you tick that this person attended. We don't want people to, misuse this opportunity. So you have to contribute to be able to earn the certificate, okay? It's not We're not Santa Claus here. We want to ensure that people earn it. Okay, not few people doing the job, and then the other people are taking from that. All right. So the videos recordings will be put on our YouTube channel. I think already you have the link to that. You can share it with colleagues to be part of this. If you have questions, we'll come up with a course evaluation towards the end of the course this week. So we have the form. Every one of you will fill online. And then in addition to that, I will make a selection of those who I will request to provide video shout outs. Usually say maximum of 3 minutes. If you go to our YouTube channel, you will see what participants said across the courses we have offered. And I think this is quite nice because it helps you to see the in-depth of the things that are happening here. Somebody's asking about breaks. Yeah, breaks are there. Breaks are there, but I'm not giving you that information beforehand. I will come back to our lunch breaks, but the breaks are, we have intermittent breaks as we go on. Okay, I have a hand up there. I have Asiebu Uzoma. Uzoma, please go ahead.
Yes, I sent you a mail, sir. I have not been assigned to a group, so I don't know how to put a group on my name.
Well, you can't put yourself, Uzoma. You can't do that. So did you fill the acceptance form?
I did, but I didn't get any response.
Okay.
I don't know what happened.
I will check that out.
I've also sent you a private chat.
I will check that out. No problem with that.
Thank you, sir.
It's no problem. Okay. So please, just to mention this again, meet yourselves for the sake of having a quiet recording. All right. Yeah, I've mentioned this, and this is what we will be doing this week. There will be lunch breaks, 11 to 12 GMT. This is GMT, okay? GMT, daily. 11, we're operating on this platform on GMT so that it's standardized across countries. So GMT 11 to 12 GMT. And that is exactly the same time in Ghana. Nigeria is 1 hour ahead. And I think people from Southern Africa be maybe 2 hours ahead of that. Okay. Yeah, I have Olayinka, please.
Yeah, good morning, Dr. Onwaru.
Good morning.
Sorry, just about you, the intermittent maybe disturbance from based on various patients not smoothing. From your control back end, you can select that mute participants upon entry. So in that case, anybody who just log in will be muted. Except such a person had to mute himself. No, some people will just, some of us will just enter, unknown to us, the video and the audio, that the mic might be on, unknown. Except that person now personally unmutes himself and maybe take off the video. So that's just my little suggestion. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much, Alain. Yeah, the problem is that we want this class to be a natural class. I get the point you're making. So sometimes people may interfere by asking questions, and I allow that. So for the courses, usually I don't do automatic muting from the beginning. But I think we can be so disciplined. I am very very nice this morning because it's the first day, it's Monday morning. But as we go forward, please, let's just put this the back of our mind. Don't interrupt so that we can have seamless. If you want to interrupt me by speaking, just do that and I will recognize you. But I prefer if you raise your hand up and then we can do it in a good way. So Olayinka, thanks very much. That is one way we do it during our seminar series, but for the course, we want it to be more natural so that people can interject when they want to, when they want to ask questions or speak. Okay. Now it's your turn. Let me give you around 5 minutes. If I have five people who can raise your hands, let me know what are your expectations. The first five I will allow. What are your expectations from this course? What are your expectations? Why did you choose to be in this course? Okay, I have Olayinka, I have Ogans, I have Leah. Yeah, I'll go in that order. Any other person? Let me see the first five. Okay, I have Ngujiri. Yeah, four. The last person who wants to speak. So please use less than 1 minute to air your point. Olayinka, go on.
Yeah, okay, thank you for the opportunity. For me, yes, since it's about writing and publishing, just to own my skill better so that I should be targeting all these Q1 journals. So I believe this should be able to empower me with the necessary skills and necessary writing art I need to be able to easily. Of course, you could have the very good results, but if I'm not able to meet the expectation of the editors and reviewer of all these maybe Q1 journals, you may find yourself having a good article, but no, maybe just being there in a, you know, either in a Q4 or not even a Scopus Index journal. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. So you actually want to hit the top journals. That is why you are here. Okay,
yes.
Great. For Gans.
Thank you, Professor Mwaru. Good morning. Yes, my expectation, just like the previous speaker, is to be able to publish in top journals because I have been receiving a lot of rejections. Sometimes it reaches to a level of like you are almost giving up. But now I expect to earn or to learn a lot from this course. And I think after this course, the rejection rate will be a bit lowered. Thank you very much.
Thanks, sir. Well, let's hope so. Let's hope so. Of course, we'll gain knowledge, but it says that a journey of 1,000 miles starts with a step. So let's see how much you can put a step faster to get into the top journal. Okay, Leah, tell us your name, then you tell us where you're joining from, which country you're joining from. It's very good to keep that in place. Leah, are you there? All right, I have Ngujiri.
Thank you so much, sir. Dirango Ngujiri, my name. I'm a PhD student at the University of Nairobi. I'm joining from Nairobi, Kenya. Well, my major reason for joining the conference, currently in Africa and globally, we have various challenges and problems that are facing society. And as Cora, we need to have a way of solving these problems. So through publication to the right journals would be one way of solving the problem we are facing in society. So my one wish is to know how to publish in good quality journals and to solve the problem the starters are facing. And then the other thing that we need to know is the quaternions, which are these quaternions? Because out there you have many journals that are not quaternions. So I want to know which are these quaternions and how can I be publishing those quaternions? Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Nguri. Okay, I have Idrisu.
My name is Idrisu. As Doc rightly mentioned, I'm from Ghana. The reason why I joined this course is that I already have a master's in economics, and now I'm doing my second master's in integrated coastal zone management at the Center of Excellence in Coastal Resilience, which means that I'm now coming here towards the scientific side, and I need to know how to write scientifically, even though I know how to, when it comes to the social aspect. And this is one of the reasons why I have interest in the course. So as for Doc, I had some personal relationship with him when initially I was not selected and I have to write emails to him and he considered me. I'm very happy to be part of this group, and I know that I'm going to learn a lot of how to write scientific. Thank you.
Great, great. Idris, it's good to have you here. You were one of those on the waiting list. And when people dropped, you got your chance. So let's hope you will make good use of it. Okay, Leah, do you have opportunity to speak now? Leah, we don't still hear you. Okay, I have Yunusa and then Bege.
Dr. Nwaru, it seems Leah is speaking. Maybe her network is bad.
Yeah, she's speaking, but we can't hear her. We can't hear her. Okay, let's go to Yunusa and then Bege, Jonathan, if Leah, you come up again, otherwise we'll move on. Okay, Yunusa, please.
Good morning, Professor Bright. Thank you so much for the opportunity. If you could remember, I was part of the group in systematic environmental analysis, and it has been very wonderful. My group has been doing very wonderful. The time you give the advert of this session, I was having palpitation. I was afraid whether I would be picked or not, and I was jittery. That's the word. But eventually, when I got my admission into the course, I was so excited. So thank you so much. I'm so grateful.
Thank you, Yunusa. It's good to have you. So you are one of those who were fasting and praying. Okay, Bege, Jonathan, please.
Good morning, Professor Bright, and other participants. Like Professor rightly mentioned, my name is Jonathan Bege from Plateau State University here in Nigeria. First of all, I want to appreciate you for this opportunity that you offered me. Actually, my dream and wish has been to be a good writer. And we all know that as scholars and researchers, the major way we can convey our ideas or solutions or our findings is through writing and publications. And if you don't know how to put your ideas or your findings into writing in the right way, then it will be very difficult for you to publish. And so, I wish and I expect that at the end of this course, I'll be able to perfect my writing skills so that I can be able to publish or add to the body of knowledge through my writing skills and to be able to publish in a very good journal. Those are my expectations. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone. And please don't forget what you have said this morning, because on Friday we'll come back to that too, to know whether your expectations have been met. I do this across my courses because it helps you to put your perspective why you have your legs in this course, and we'll come back to that. So please, those who are joining now, if you have not renamed yourself, please do so. Rename yourself by going to the top right corner of your name and put your group there, because I see some of you do not have your groups there. It helps us when we are assigning you to the group participation. We'll do that seamlessly without wasting too much time. There are many of you in this forum. Okay, now I will give you 10 minutes break. I have spoken for 50 minutes almost. And let's come back at the top of the hour. So it will be 9 a.m. GMT. Let's come back 9 a.m. GMT. So it's 9 minutes from now. Let's come back and continue. Okay, welcome back, everyone. Welcome back, everyone. Let's continue. Just to say that if we have not granted you opportunity to attend this course and you are here, maybe you got the link from your friend, or I'm not sure how you get here. We're not going to allow that. There are 671 people who applied to this course, and we couldn't take everybody. So we wouldn't want to cheat those who would have been in a position to get a place, but we are refused like other people. So if you are here without giving the opportunity to attend the course, I will encourage you to quietly leave now, because then it's not right. Okay, we want to keep those that have been accepted, and we want to allow justice to be in place. All right, just to mention that. All right. Okay, so I've been going through the introduction, and we have I've introduced ourselves. This course is hands-on, like we advertised. This course is hands-on, like we advertised. So we're going to focus on the basics, fundamental issues, and we're going to do that through few lecture sessions, but there will be lots of group work, group discussions. There will be group project at the end. And of course, I love these nuggets. And I know many of you already love it, having participated in our previous courses. Those nuggets are good. So we'll take it across the groups. Group one, just to mention, group one, tomorrow morning, before we start the lectures, you're going to present to us your first nugget. So the nuggets are in your folders on the Google Drive. So locate it, and then get ready by tomorrow, meet as a group, assign somebody who will present it. So just use 3 minutes maximum to tell us what that paper is all about. Those papers we have selected and put there are there to give you additional insight into what the discussion this week is all about, beyond what we are treating in class here. So please do that. Group one, before we start our so before we start our lecture tomorrow, then group two, your first nugget will come just before the lunch tomorrow. Group three, your first nugget will come after lunch tomorrow. And group four will be before we end. I will come back to group five and group six, seven, and eight. The goal is that each group will present at least one nugget before the end of this course. So each group has two nuggets in their folder. So let's see how much we can get through them. Okay, and then we'll have the group project. It is learning by doing. Yeah, you have the link to the Google Drive. You have the groups that are there. And of course, I have mentioned you have short breaks to really minimize too much sitting and adding immobility. So, okay, so you have the groups. This is one of the things I usually present, how to disagree. in your group, you have lots of discussions. I have lots of discussions. So please, if you are not speaking, just mute yourself, please. If you're not speaking, mute yourself. All right, so you have lots of discussion within your group, and then how do you disagree? Please, let's focus on explicitly refuting the central point. No name calling. Let's go to the top there. That is why we are scholars. That is why we are scientists, okay? No name calling. Let's focus on the issues. All right. Your group project, as usual, Friday is a free day for myself and a big day for you, okay? Where you're going to tell us how you have come through this week. So you have a group project, and I have put it in your different group folders as well. So you have information in your group folders that describe what is expected of you. Make your Google Drive group folder your friend this week, because many of the things I will say here, many of the things there, I wouldn't say them here, because you have that. Some of them I will forget. So the group project is aimed at giving you, the participants, a deeper appreciation of the scientific writing process in which I have given you in your group real time or real world data you're going to analyze. You're going to interpret the data, and then you're going to prepare a full scientific paper from the analysis you have done. And the goal is that as we take these steps one after the other this week, you are going to implement the skills and the tools we'll be showcasing here in your writing processes. And on Friday, you are going to present what you have done. So at the end of the course, each group will submit to me a full written scientific paper based on the exercise they have done. And then on Friday, you're going to have 10 minutes presentation of that process you have taken to come to this point. Okay, that is what it is. So please read your group folder for the instruction we have given here, okay? So I have the data I have given to each group. In that data, I have taken it from the World Bank, and this data are real data. They are not fabricated, they are not fictitious. They are real data of what is happening in the world, and I've given you description of what each group should do. So look at it, and you have to start in earnest today. Meet, create WhatsApp group, create Telegram group, however you want to do it, and connect. Just connect amongst yourself and find a way to deal with this issue. It's going to be a heavy week, but it's going to be a fruitful week at the end. All right, so I will send you out now to your group session. We have a breakout session for half an hour. And what we are going to do there is to describe this. I don't want you to use your phone. Don't use your phone. Just listen to me. Don't use your phone. Because what I'm going to send you out now is to get you begin to work. And this is a learning process. It works well. Don't use your phone. Don't use your computer. No internet. Just get in there with your group and try to answer this question. What is scientific writing? Okay? What is scientific writing? Can you imagine what is it? And is it a science or is it an art? And that is scientific writing. Is scientific writing a science? Is an art? So that is what you will be doing in your breakout sessions. And so I'm going to create that. Now, please, I will let you to select it. Select, it comes to the front of your gadget, your computer, your phone. Select your group where you belong and go there. Those who cannot, I will assign you. Some of you have not put your group names there, and that makes it really difficult to get you to your group. Change your audition and put your group name there. So in 30 minutes, I will call you back. Discuss with your group and they reach a consensus. Let one person come and use 1 minute to tell us what you have found out.
Professor Bright, it's still us all stable. I don't know where to break out to. I need your assistance, please.
Yeah, Osama, I couldn't find your information. Is that the name you used to apply to this course?
Yes, I use Osama Sebu. I've always used it for other courses I've participated in.
I couldn't find. Did you accept your participation in the course?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let's quickly go through this. So I'm giving each group 1 minute, just 1 minute, to summarize what you have discussed here. And I hope you have had a good deliberation. So group one, who is representing group one? Please go on. And please remember to mute your mics. Group one.
Yes, hello.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, do you hear me? Yeah, in group one, we saw that scientific writing combined the two. It's both science and the arts. We say that because for when a scientific use science, it is in that way, the technique, that scientific use, technical writing that scientists do use to communicate their research. Communicating those figures, methods used in different research. It is art as well, because it has to be precise, to design, to be well designed. We say that it is also a way, a scientific use to create, to involve creation, to express themselves. And also it is different, using those different techniques, a scientific design and be precise, using words and phrase.
Okay, thanks very much. Thanks very much. Okay, let's go to group two. So group one says it is both science and art. Group two.
Yeah, I'm Chioma, presenting for group two.
Okay,
so in my group, we concluded that scientific writing is both an art and a science. because we say that when you're talking of art, you're talking about creativity, imagination, and the beauty. And these are the things you have to incorporate in your writing. Your choice of vocabulary, even starting from choosing an appropriate journal, the style, the format. And then even though it's evidence-based and it's called scientific, if you remove the creativity, the ability to express your thoughts and knowledge and engage the reader, you lose the beauty and the art of scientific writing. And then we said also it's a science because it also involves, science involves the build, the organization, and the systematic arrangement. And then when you talk of science also, for example, you are doing data analysis, it's part of writing, that is scientific. So, and you're talking about introduction, materials and methods, result, discussion, putting all of them together involves both art and science. So we concluded that scientific writing is both an art and a science. Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much. So group one and group two are green. Group three.
Group three, yes. Hello. So with group three, we, in our perspective, we concluded that scientific writing is both an art and a science. We realized that they are both interdependent. They are all running on a parallel line leading to a targeted end. And we stated that it's a scientific writing because it follows a certain systematic order. There's a specific and technical language that is used, which falls under the artistic design. It is professional, it is audience-centered, it uses jargon, it uses formal language, it has intricate detail, and use the IMRAD format. And the IMRAD format categorizes the introduction, the methods, the results, and the discussion. So we have that. And we also identify the art as in being us knowing or identified within a certain genre of writing. Therefore, we focus on the type of writing, whether it is, should be clear language, simple language, how ordered it should be to transmit the new scientific findings that we are actually churning out to the targeted audience, okay, written for an appropriate language. So
thanks very much. Okay, group four. So you're all agreeing to the same.
We in group four are not different from other speakers. We also come to the agreement that scientific writing is a combination of both art and science, in the sense that the artistic way of how you express, how you present, and how you design your work and format it to look beautiful, attractive, and catch the attention of the audience to get to read it. And then the scientific aspect has to do with the language and, of course, observing and obeying scientific methodology and science ethics and principles so that it is actually accepted in the scientific world.
Thanks very much. Okay, group five.
Thank you very much.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, Olayinka is presenting. Yes, out of the 13 of us, only four of us saw ourselves. We don't know why. Even our leader couldn't see. But we agreed that the scientific writing is both scientific and arts way. We talk about why scientific, that it needs to follow a procedure which is evidence-based and can be validated in one's area of specialization, and also it should be reproducible. And it is art because it requires creativity to make it appealing to the audience, which entails the editors, the reviewers, and policymakers, et cetera. And we agree that there are a lot of great works that never made it to the final audience. Why? Because they were not presented in an appealing manner to the watchmen, to the gatemen, talking about the editors and the reviewers. So in conclusion, it's both scientific and both artistic. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Group five, now group six, please.
Thank you very much. I'm Yunusa.
Yes, please.
Appearing for group. We addressed this, we recognized that there were two questions. One, what is scientific writing? And two, is it a science or art? And we identified that there are four concepts there. And the four concepts, one, writing, two, science, three, and art, four. So we tried to write, writing a skill required to transfer information by imprinting letters in a particular medium. Science is a systematic approach in the study of nature, both of living and non-living and their interactions, while art is a skill required to present or communicate in a creative manner. So our conclusion was that scientific writing is a systematic approach to report on outcome of systematic studying of nature, both living and non-living and their interactions. And we agree that scientific writing is both science and art. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let's go to group 7.
Thank you, Prof. Ndirango Mujiri, on behalf of group 7, who are the members Uzima, Emmanuel, Jer, Amanda, Godswill, and Karen. I'm going to present them to you. The question is scientific writing and art or science. Well, we concur with the previous groups, and thank you for the presentation, that scientific writing is an art and a science at the same time. Why is it an art? It is because we require the skills and the ability to communicate to the general audience. Most of the consumers of our writings, they don't have the scientific knowledge, and we need, for example, the policymakers in the governments, in the NGOs, they don't have the knowledge, and we need to communicate to them. That's making it an art because of the communication part of it. And then why is it a science? When coming up with the data, when you're collecting our data, we require to have the knowledge and the in-depth knowledge of the requirements in this field. So we need to have this science for us to come up with good knowledge. And when you're analyzing and writing our findings, we require to have the science in it. In conclusion, we made that the scientific writing is both a science and an art. Thank you, Prof. Back to you.
Group 8, thanks very much, group 7. Let's up group 8.
Thank you, Prof. This is Kelvin, group 8, and being the last group, hope this gives the summary of everything. So the question was, what is scientific writing? And we define that as the process of reporting or presenting the findings that can be reproduced. So the next question was, is it an art or a science? So we agreed, the 9 of us, that it's both an art and a science. An art in terms of communicating your findings and your discoveries to the rest of the world, and a science in terms of being reproduced, like when you present it to the rest of the world, then they can disprove you or agree with you, and they will use methods. So those methods will be scientific. So it's a science and an art. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, all the groups. You know, as a teacher, if I grade you now, if I grade the groups, I will grade group 8, maybe close to 100%. And then group 1 to 7, I will give them 50%. Okay. Does anyone oppose that? Any group oppose that grade? Is it obvious?
Yes, it is.
You agree to that grade, isn't it?
Of course I do. You need
okay.
The first part. Yes, yeah.
So can you expatiate why you do? Just agree with me like that.
Yeah, I agree because the question is in two parts. What's scientific writing?
Great.
Science and art. So we took the second part. Yeah.
Yeah. So now not as a scientist, you have failed in that part because your observation was wrong. So you took, the observation was actually half. So I asked two questions here. What is scientific writing? Only group 8 answered the first part. The main question, you can see this, the second one is quite small.
No, no, yeah. No, sir. Group 6 also.
Group 6 disagreeing.
Group 6 also answered that question.
Because group 6 answered that.
We said there are 2 questions and there are 4 concepts.
All right. That is great. Accepted. I have Dr. Chukwe Meka Mwikwe. There, you're raising your hand.
Yes, Prof, I don't agree with the score that you gave. Because group 8, they waited until we all finished all what we had to present before they said that. And he said it when he was presenting it. So you see that group 2 and group 4, groups 2 and 4, they really try to explain what scientific, the art of scientific writing, what it is.
Okay. What happen, what happens is that no matter the argument you make on this question, this is one of the questions you're going to answer this week. So don't spend your don't sweat. Okay. You will still get your certificate at the end of the course. But for now, for this one question, accept my grading. All right. So well, the fact is this. You have answered well all the groups. You have really captured it. And I think this gives a message. Please, there's somebody who has the mic on. Please mute yourself so that we don't have background noise. Okay. So the question here we have just addressed now is quite important for all of us because you know you are a mixture of different disciplines. You are a mixture of these different disciplines. And that is one thing, personally, as a scientist, I try to capture in my daily work as a scientist. I try to capture it. And what I'm trying to capture is that I need the support of a psychologist. I need the support of a theologian. I need the support of a mathematician. I need the support of a medical doctor. I need the support of different people, okay? Science itself, what is it? In my own definition, is a process whereby we make observation in nature, and through those observations, we can find solutions to our daily living, okay? And those observations can be supported by different disciplines. And so many times when we make a demarcation. No, I'm a qualitative researcher. You're a qualitative researcher. For me, really, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense to engage in those arguments. It doesn't make sense. I have a current project I'm working with now, and that project is how do I make what I am, the research I'm doing, to be understandable to the lay people who are in the community, who have no scientific background. Eventually, they are the ones who are contributing data to what I'm doing. Eventually, they are the ones also who in their different ways are supporting the funding of this research. But many times, there is no give back. They are hanging out there that all I do is to publish to the scientific community, which serves a particular audience. You know, and so in this research now, I am trying to get these lay people to come into to form a group so that when I'm designing my research question, they can contribute to that because eventually they will benefit from it. So there is no need for me to think that the qualitative researcher who will help me to organize things like focus group discussion, which I don't have skills to do, that her skills are not important. No. So just to highlight here, let's be very, very realistic and practical that science depends on art. Art depends on science. There is a symbiotic relationship that we have. And the ultimate goal is that we all contribute our expertise, our quota in pushing a better society. And we can do that not independently, but working together. Okay, so your definitions are we taking and they are in the right direction. Those who continue to persist on background noise, I will kick you out once that continues. Don't just mute your mic when you come in. All right. What is scientific writing? The process of effectively communicating the results of scientific research and the processes that led to obtaining those results. Okay? So you can see communication coming in here. The process of effectively communicating. That section of communication, however you want to look at it, it is an independent characteristic of the art. Creativity, one of the groups mentioned creativity, innovation, character, persuasion, description is very important, okay? But you know, when you write or when you communicate, there must be an audience, okay? There must be an audience. And it's very important to highlight that when you talk about scientific writing, it also has a specific audience. It is not every audience that is included here. Before I go to that, let me mention that when I mention science here and scientific or however you call it, I am using it very loosely to mean all the different science types we have, social sciences, natural sciences, medical sciences, technical sciences, they are all included here. So feel comfortable if you are an educationist, feel comfortable if you're a theologian, feel comfortable if you're a medical doctor, feel comfortable if you're a computer scientist, feel comfortable if you're an engineer in this course, because we are all going to benefit. I want to learn from you. And I want you to also share from my own experience, okay? So on my left here, you can see you have the scientists and there are different ways that they need to communicate. There are different actors in the society, journalists, you have a press office and so on and so forth. We need to have a channel where we communicate what we do as scientists. Okay. Now, there is a difference you can see between scientific writing and science writing. Science writing sometimes can be called science communication. Scientific writing and science writing. Scientific writing has its own audience, and science writing has its own audience. So it is the audience that really differentiates these perspectives. On the right here, you have the inner circle where you have the scientific writing or scientific communication, where it is targeted at the peers within the scientific community. So what we are dealing with in this week is reaching to those who are like us, okay? Reaching to those who are like us. So scientific writing looks at specific professional audience, and in that we have our jargons and formal language we use to express the things we do. We involve in intricate details, and there are some laid down formats or structures that are used to make this communication effective. And once you go against that, you can't even go against that because you have to follow, you're publishing to a journal, you have to follow the structures that are laid down. And you're not allowed to derail from it. But when you move to science writing, science communication is a different cup of tea, really. And that includes a host of different audiences, the general public, the business community, you're writing for children, you're writing for patient groups, trade organizations, other interest groups, agencies, policymakers, school teachers, journalists, and so on and so forth. Okay, and that becomes an area that is very intricate. That is one of the 10 courses we want to organize perhaps next year. We will bring science communication. Please meet yourself meet yourself. Just to repeat it again, if you come in, meet yourself. If you come in, meet yourself. Otherwise, I will kick you off if you disturb the recording. So meet yourself, please, when you come in, so that we... Okay. So when you are trying to reach these people here, these audiences, then your language is different from when you are writing to the scientific community. Instead of the jargons we use, the language become plain and informal. Instead of intricate details, we focus on overarching ideas. Instead of following the formats that are there, the structures, we undertake a narrative process. But one thing that is common, we will look at this afternoon, between whether you're doing scientific writing or science writing, is one of the groups mentioned it, clarity. Clarity. You need to be clear. The goal is to communicate. The goal is to make people understand. The goal is to say your point clearly so that somebody can take your story, interpret it, and apply it. When I was at the secondary school or high school, however you call it, in my country, my English teacher, we mentioned, she used the word simplicity. Simplicity. And she told a story. She said, you know, in one school, announcement was made that a professor was visiting that school. In those days, she said, there were really few professors who were around. And most of them were old. So people became professors in their old age. The gray hair was there, and they spoke in deep voices. And so this secondary school, it was announced that a professor was visiting that school. Wow. It's not common to see professors. The children were excited. The school announced it, sensitized them, and they were excited, waiting. But you know why they were waiting? Because professors are known to be those who speak the big grammar. Goodness me. In my country, in Nigeria, I used to know this guy who was in the parliament, who speaks all kinds of, God knows, weird grammar that it was terrible. He speaks in the parliament and his colleagues end up giving him round of applause. But if you ask each of them, what did he say? Nobody can interpret what, can understand what he has said. But you know what? All he has said, all the big grammar he has said, they are all correct. But nobody understood that. So this professor was coming to this school, my English teacher was saying, and the day he came, he started speaking very simple. Oh, my children, I am happy to be with you today. I know you have all been looking forward to see me, and I've been looking forward to see you too. So this is a very wonderful day for me. And he didn't go far, and there was hissing, oh, complaining, moaning, oh, everywhere there was noise. He was surprised. What is the problem? He asked the teachers, and they said, the children were actually expecting that you would speak big grammar because that's what professors speak. And you're speaking the things they already know. And the professor changed and started blowing hot with those big grammars. And there was a round of applause everywhere. The children were clapping for him. But the question is, did they understand what he said? No. They didn't understand what he said. So Many times we can be in that situation. So whether you're writing scientifically, or you're doing science writing or communication, the goal is to be clear with your message. The goal is to ensure that people understand. And if you take scientific journals, you can see that the higher you go, I mean, the higher in the ranking of journals you go, the simpler the language they use. Can you imagine that? In the area of medicine, the highest ranked journal is called the New England Journal of Medicine. Other ones are like Lancet or JAMA, Journal of American Medical Association, or BMJ, British Medical Journal, and so on and so forth. Those top journals, you read their papers, you see how simple expressions are made because they have hired communicators who will bring down those messages and make it simple, because the goal is to be understood. So this week, I'm not sure how you have been, how you have been writing. I want to push it forward here that one thing I would like us to achieve at the end of this week is to become simple scientists. Not just in how you appear, because scientists are poor people, really. So we don't have money for big clothing. But even in your simple appearance, don't be the hard type that use big language to really push people to the wall. And when they read, they knock their head, wow, what is this? No, let us end this week by becoming so simple in our expression that our language becomes so sweet. And that is where the art becomes important, the art part of scientific writing. Being able to be creative, download it, dissect it, make it simple. We will try to see how we can achieve that this week. And so when you start your project, have this in the back of your mind. So the audience is very important, and the audience determines the content, the setting, and the medium of communication. For scientific writing, we publish in journals, we write in our thesis, bachelor's thesis, master's thesis, PhD thesis, and technical reports that are written, and conference presentation. But overall, in the scientific writing, we write to scientists like ourselves, not to the lay population. I'm not saying that when you write to scientists, you write like you're writing to the lay population. No, but simplicity is an overarching goal that we aim to achieve, regardless of the audience we write to. Okay. All right. So I will send you again back to your group breakout rooms. Today is setting the context. Okay. No hurry. We are taking our time to set the context today, because from tomorrow, we are getting into the nitty-gritty to push ourselves to the wall. I want you to get a context. Get the context really well. From when you establish the context, you have sweetness in your mind to move on forward. Okay. Now, I'll give you until we have our break. And what you're going to do is I want you to document it, because there will be no time to make those presentations. I want you to document it. If we have some time when we come back from the lunch break, we will see how much we can get into this. But document it and send it to me. Document it and send this work. You can take a picture. You can take a picture of this so that you know what you're supposed to do. Document it and send it to me at the end of this session. Send it to me, for I will create a folder in this so that everybody can tap into what other people have said, okay, and gain knowledge. Let's collaborate. One of the things I forgot to say at the beginning of the meeting today Yeah, somebody has the mic on. Who is that? Can you mute, please? Can you mute, please? So what I wanted to say, I forgot, is that this is a forum. This is not your typical classroom or course. This is a forum where we bring Africans from all walks of life as scientists to come to share. One of the philosophies I have as a scientist is freely you have received, freely give. Share your experience. No hoarding of information, because a scientific process and as scientists, our goal is to change the narrative of our society. And for Africa, there is room for us to improve. So let's share. Let's share. Open up, open up, open up. These discussions, open up. Open up yourself. From when you open up yourself, then at the end of this week, you'll be filled with things to think about and get you. So if you have not changed your name, I mean, you have not renamed yourself and put your group there, please do that and take a picture of this. So you go and you have to narrate why is writing and publishing important for your scientific career? Why do you think this is important? Some of you have given expectations and mentioned some things there, but why is this important for you? Outline and discuss 5 benefits of scientific writing and publishing to you. Okay? And in 5 phrases or words, short ones, describe your writing experience. When some of you were applying to this course, say that this is an area I struggled with. This is an area I struggled with. And that is why you went into fasting and prayer to be accepted to this course. Now you are accepted. Tell us, what is that your experience is? What is writing to you? Is it hard to you? Is it easy? Is it exciting? Is it something you take? I will just kick this sleep out. I want to do this. I want to write this. Tell us what it is. Tell us 5 phrases. And each group should collect all this from the group members and, of course, discuss. From this document, we are going to share it. We're going to share it. You will not know the impact this document will make in the life of other people. What aspect of the scientific writing process do you find most easy or difficult? Okay, let's get it out. How productive has been your writing and publishing during the last 5 years? Have you achieved your expectations during this period? If yes, what has been your strategies of success? If no, what have been your barriers? And you can share any thoughts of how to overcome those barriers. I want this to be an engaging and fruitful discussion. Let those who have gone far in the cadre of their career share their experiences. Let those who are young, who are struggling, let's share this experience. And I think it will help us. So I will call you close to 45 minutes time. I don't think we'll have 45 minutes to. And then we can go for lunch and come back with this course. All right, let me open the rooms. Please join your room. Okay, welcome back. Welcome back, everyone. I hope your discussions have been fruitful. Does anyone want to share a quick thing before we go for lunch break? Any quick feedback?
Hello. Jonathan Biki from group 4.
Yeah, Jonathan.
Actually, the time allocated, I think, is very, very short.
Very, very short.
I said the time is short. We could not even exhaust the question, yes, sir.
You couldn't exhaust the question.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Any other group has the same feeling?
Yes, group 1.
Group 1. Group three. Mm-hmm.
Group six.
And group eight, we have something for group eight. They should not say that we copied from them again.
Okay. All right, everybody. Okay.
We have something we can present.
Yeah, no, this is not time to present. You're not presenting now. I just want to know your feedback. So what I get from what you're saying is that you are enjoying that group work. You're enjoying it.
Yes.
That's true.
Yes.
It's true. So that is what you are telling me. Not that the time was not enough. You're enjoying it.
No, we are enjoying it. Yes.
Uh-huh, great.
We are enjoying it, and the time is so short.
No, when you're enjoying it, you don't want the time to end.
We'll use a lunch break for it.
No, so what will happen is that, so there will be no presentation. Now, what I will do is that this work, you will continue it until Friday.
Oh, okay.
So when you meet in your group,
You can
take 5 minutes to say, let's discuss this more, continue it. Because it's very important, as you can see, it's very important to share these experiences.
Yes.
Mm. So on Friday, I will collect it. Okay. And then perhaps we can see if we can make presentation about that. But it is good to make this discussion. We can't stay on that breakout session forever. So you continue that, and we'll have to take a break, a lunch break now, and we'll continue and we'll move on. All right. So let's come back at exactly the hour. So 12 noon GMT, which should be Nigerian 1 p.m., Finland 2 p.m., Rwanda perhaps 2 p.m., and of course, other people, just figure out your own time there. So see you at 1 o'clock.
Okay.
Thank you. Enjoy your lunch. Thank you.
Enjoy your lunch too.
Bon appétit.
Thank you.
Bon appétit.
Oui, bon appétit.
Merci.
Anyone care for lunch? Anyone care to join me?
Okay, welcome back, everyone. I hope you have had a good lunch. So we need to kick off now. We have 2 hours to go for today. So let's take it. And so I will send you out again to the to your breakout sessions. Well, like I said, today is setting the context. You have discussed two issues since we started. Discuss what scientific writing is, whether it is science or art. I think that was a good one that came from you. And then we discussed the issues and motivations for writing, and that work, you have to continue with it. As I said, until Friday when I will collect it. So keep making your list, harmonize your list across the groups, and then we'll discuss them Friday, and I will collect the list from you. So please, as you can see, there are lots of group work here. And that is how it's going to be until we finish this course. Please, the group coordinators, ensure that you are taking note of each group session and ensure that you have everyone on that list, those who are contributing to the discussion. Now, I would like you to discuss a particular issue of importance. And I know that many of you are familiar with this concept, publish or perish. Okay, is there anyone who is not familiar with this concept? Is anyone who is not familiar with this concept?
It's common to me.
It's common to everyone, isn't it? Nobody has an issue with this. All right. So this is the concept that if you don't publish, and you, please, I would just like you as you come in, meet yourself. This is the concept that a scientist must publish, not just publish. You must publish well, and you must publish highly. Otherwise, the system will naturally kick you off. So it's either you publish or you perish, because without publication, you can't be promoted, you can't get money, you can't have influence. So you are there to publish. So please meet yourself, please, so that we minimize the background noise in this recording. And so I will send you out, and what I want you to do is to deliberate on this concept. Deliberate on its implication for science as a whole, the goal of science, which I've highlighted since morning, to make the society a happy place. What are the implications of this aspect of what we do to science and to scientists? Because this may affect scientists in different ways, okay? And then you have the also issue of incentivizing, whereby scientists are given incentives for promotion, incentives for grants, incentives for tenure, also based on performance, also based on publication, and so on and so forth. What are the implications of this for science and scientific writing? Should this system of incentivizing be abolished, or should we maintain it? If we should abolish it, if that is your viewpoint, what will you suggest to be an alternative to this? Okay, so the groups, I'm giving you 30 minutes. Go and collect your viewpoint on this. When you come, I will give each group 2 minutes to highlight. And then at the end of today, the group coordinator should send me their input, the viewpoint you have collected. So send it to me and I will collect them and put on the folder. Others can see what your deliberations, what your thoughts are. Okay, any question on this? All right, so I send you out now, and then please take a picture of this so that you can have your thoughts. If you have not added your group to your name, please do so, because it makes it easier to assign you to your groups. Add your group number to your name.
Greetings, Dr. Bright. I've not been assigned to a group.
Who is speaking?
Yeah, this is Anyaso Goswe from Babcock University.
Yeah, I think you have been assigned. I think you have been dormant since morning in your distance.
No, No, I wasn't dormant. Actually, I thought I typed group seven. I typed group one. So in the morning, I was sent to group one. So what I did now was to change it to group seven.
Is it?
So that I can go to the right group.
So this is, so okay. So you are in group one, but your group is group seven.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So I send you there.
All right, thank you.
I have Bartolomeo. Which group are you? You need to change. You need to change. Rename yourself so that it's easier to assign you. I have Job. You have to put your this. I have George, Delphine. Please put your group number to your names. Then it's easier because your time is going.
Oh, that time was too short.
Let's go straight to the business. I know if I give you the whole day for this one question, the time will be short. So let's move on and see what we can achieve. I said earlier, when you're enjoying a matter, the time is always short too. Okay, which is good. Let's go to group one. In 2 minutes, tell us what you have observed, group one. What is your concern? What is your argument? What are you advocating for? Group one, who is representing group one?
Okay, group one, publish or perish in science. So we have both negative and positive implications. So for the negative implication is that the scholars are forced to publish even on low impact journals, and it puts pressure on scholars to publish or perish, regardless of how credible or the publication is. And then also the pressure leads to substandard research output, and the image of the researcher is also affected negatively. And then sometimes it leads to brain tumor because you don't sleep. You develop abnormal eating, and you have got that pressure to publish. And then positively, a paper well written can be published in each and every journal. So with clear comments and methodology, the results will also be clear. So it encourages collaboration between institutions and beyond. And it also encourages scientists to go into publication, and it contributes to knowledge positively. And then also you are visible, and you can be promoted wherever you are because of the research. And then on number two, where you are deliberating on academic incentivizing promotion, grant tenure, or based on publication, and what are the implications for science scientific writing? We are saying it improves science. You do more work and achieve more. So it improves productivity and encourages innovation. You give your best, so it encourages research. So when you are funded, you are also motivated to continue publishing, and it promotes grit. Sometimes it promotes grit because you may not finish the project, regardless of whether you are given money. You just want to collect the money, and then the quality is very poor. So it's also, you just move on to the next project. So it also, the point is that it promotes formalization of journals aspect, or of, let's say you concentrate on money and then the quality of paper is affected. So it promotes evidence-based decision-making. And then should it be abolished or maintained? We say that it should be maintained. Because if it is quality and focus, why should it be abolished?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Okay, so we should maintain it.
Yeah.
All right, thank you, group one. Group two, let's hear from you.
Hello?
Yeah, we're here.
Okay, I'm Shoma speaking for group two. So the first question is the deliberation on the concept
So actually, as we most of us know, publish of which is the pressure mounted on academics, especially in research universities, to publish papers in order to get promotion grants and the rest of them. Implication on science. It has both negative and positive. On science, there is death of scientific progress because so most times it's poor quality work, because of the pressure, people publish poor quality work that make little or no impact on the progress of science. And then there is also, like I said, poor research work. People are impatient. They can't stay in the lab and work. They just want to put it out as soon as possible. Then on the scientists, one of the major things that there's lack of confidence. Like I was discussing with my group, a new professor telling me that he can't be an inaugural lecture because he doesn't know anything. It's as bad as that. And then we have the publication of non-credible works. Sometimes they are recalled, and it's a shame when your work is recalled because you're under pressure to just get something out. And then most times when the scientists, you become a victim of predatory journals that even during the promotion, they'll be rejected. And then another important implication on the scientists is that it kills that passion we have as scientists, because if you're truly a scientist, have this passion to make an impact in your society. And that passion is killed because of this pressure to just put anything out and get promoted. Then implication on science, positively, it can also advance science because some people are lazy and they have to be pushed to work. So researchers are forced to work, and sometimes these works produce groundbreaking results or discoveries. And then positively on the scientists, as you work, you gain knowledge, you gain visibility, you can get collaboration, get grants to do more work, and then you have job satisfaction in what you're doing. And then on the issue of whether it should be abolished or not, if we discuss that it shouldn't be abolished, because abolishing it can generate lazy researchers that will do little or nothing to get promoted. Okay. And then there is also evidence of adequate knowledge to get promoted, you improve yourself. And then the last thing was what then can be done? So we say that instead of hinging only on publications to get promoted, we can also look at performance at other aspects of work, evaluation by colleagues or students, the innovation you'd be able to put on the table, your mentoring ability,
all right,
the quality and relevance.
Thank
of
you very much.
You
thank you very much. Good to your point. The last point you're making are fantastic. I think it would be good to develop those points and share, as I said, so that we can give to other groups, because the point you're making are some of the things other people are also advocating, not only publication, but be able to get a comprehensive viewpoint. Some people are introvert by nature, some are extrovert, and this can also affect the way they get their feedback, of what they do and promotion and things like that. So getting perspective from those around you and looking at other metrics can be a support system. So that point is there. Important and we're taking. Okay, group three, quickly.
Okay, thank you. In group three, we go direct to the implications of publish or perish in the science. We have both negative and positive. The negative one, we have seen that this concept makes academicians focus more on publication to the extent that they leave other important matters of transferring knowledge to the undergraduates and the graduate students, to the point, to the extent that you cannot find someone who is capable to fit the professor's position. The positive one is that a scientist will have to publish to be regarded as experts in the field, because we know when you publish, we keep reviewing what others are doing, and we keep we get to know what is currently going on in the field. Whether to promote or not to promote, we argue that we should promote publication because it enhances that promotion should be maintained. Grants are also very important, as they enhance collaboration with others in the field. Publication in higher quality journal becomes more easy if there is funding. The grants won should be part of the promotion. If, for instance, in an institution, there is no funding. But we also argue that tenure should be shortened to force scientists to work hard to do research. Instead of maybe putting 10 years, it can go to 3 to 4 years.
Thank okay. You. Thank you. All right, group four. Group four. Who's speaking for group four?
It's me. Sorry.
Okay.
Yes, we did deliberate on the public or parish concept. And we found also that there are some positives and negatives to the concept. The first question, we realized that one of the positive things about the publish or perish concept is that it helps to advance science as new things are added.
It looks like Patricia is off.
And then as for academic incentivizing, we not like scientists become prey to predatory journals. And then also the funders of the researchers mostly lead the narrative, and this leads to publication bias. It also promotes segregation amongst the scientists because of the promotion ranks. And then the positives is that it encourages hard work and good quality research is produced when funding is available. And also it reduces economic pressure on the scientists because of easier access to the grants. In as far as whether it should be abolished or maintained, we felt like it shouldn't be abolished because it provides scientists with the financial resources that they need to conduct and publish their research findings. However, we feel like the criteria should be reviewed from time to time and laid out clearly to avoid abuse. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Group five. Who is speaking for group five?
Yeah, sorry. So this is Ola Inka Oko speaking for group five.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, publish or perish. From our excerpts, we say it puts pressure on scientists, hence there is poor quality publications out there, and also it encourages a predatory journal, which we know to be a multi-million dollar industry, and it was also raised that it brings desperation from the scientists and also falsification of results, just like also there are publications that does not address the needs of the community. So whether it should be abolished, well, we said it shouldn't be completely abolished, or whether it should be tied to incentives and other. We said no, it should not be completely abolished. Rather, there should be a benchmark for the type of acceptable publication. And also promotion should not be attached to it. Rather, it should be attached to other yardsticks, like in the Western world, where people are not so much in a hurry, so much to publish out of desperation, yet they are growing in their career. It means promotion are also tied to some other things aside publication. So we end up that people should be encouraged to publish rather than being punished for not publishing quality work or not just any form of publication. Then on the issue of alternative, we encourage that government should fund researches so that private donors can also come on board, because from one of your work that we did in Time Park, remember that the more the government own this thing, the more the private sector also come in to fund them research. So we also okay. Say yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks very much, group five. Let's go to group six. Group six, what was your deliberation?
All right, good afternoon. So my name is Rebecca Omidubaba. So we spoke about whether to publish or perish. So we spoke about each one to come out with the clear understanding of it. So we looked at about the importance of the publishing. So we wrote 5 points, and then we spoke about to expose us to the real world by communicating our findings. It also brings out new invention in us. It recognizes or acknowledges experts in various fields, and then it promotes us in our field of work. And then it also increases the skills and volume of publishing. So the perishing comes in when it keeps us in the dark side of the world, whereby we are not exposed to information, ideas, and skills, and then ignorance of data available to use, and then lack of recognition or progress in subject area. So the importance of publication to science, we also said that it increases knowledge in science. For example, the guidelines to be formulated or reviewed to influence certain change. It also brings about evidence which is needed to carry out findings. And then for policy makers to improve on decision. So we also said it brings about numerous discoveries in various aspects, and it creates the awareness.
Okay. Thank you very much, Group 6. Let's go to Group 7. Group 7
will be presented by me. My name is Amanda Ode. So for us, in looking at the concepts of public shall perish and its implication for science and scientific research, we defined public shall perish as an academic practice which seeks to place the mandate of publishing on the staff and is subject to their promotion and career sustainability. And we are saying that this has implication, positive and negative implication. Positive in the sense that it helps advance knowledge and science as it creates an environment for people to carry out research on existing topics and new ones to reinvent ourselves as academics. However, this has implication for what people do and how they carry out science. It creates an environment for people to look for shortcuts to survive, so they produce low quality research. It creates an environment where people place emphasis on quantity as against quality. And this has implication for science and scientific writing as well. Where people also produce works which do not have impact. And it also puts people's career out of control, because there may be people who are not publishing but are quality materials for academia. We also said that it has implication for fair participation, especially in terms of gender, where other roles and activities come into play when people have to work. So if it doesn't take into consideration that people have other responsibilities outside of academia, and this has implication for us. And then academic incentivizing and science. We also have the fact that it has this positive and negative, and the positive aspects that we have is that it creates a forum where there's healthy competition and where the best ideas get noticed. Because grants are competitive, the kind of works that get funded are good quality projects, and so it helps bring out quality work and also promotes healthy competition.
Okay, thank you very much, Group 7. Let's hear Group 8.
Okay. Thank you, Prof. It's true that everyone has spoken again. So Group 8, we have the fear that if we repeat the same things that the other groups have said, they will say that we have waited until they have said so. So we just want to add what they have missed out. That for example, in the first question of to deliberate on the concept of publish or perish, we think that while they have said every other thing, there is a need for visibility, there's a need for credibility. The one thing we want to add was that we wanted to consider the pull and the push factors for perish or publish. And we are of the opinion that advancement or promotion is a publication, this should be reviewed, and it should only be the only criterion for promotion. Also, we looked at the challenges that we face in our continent, in Africa, that we have to combine, research and teaching. So that also should be reviewed, so that we consider that as one of the pull and push factors. There was also the question of the challenge of publication in open access, which now brings us to the cost of funding. Many Africans or researchers in Africa do not meet that criteria. So what happens? Most of our studies are perishing, so we cannot meet that aspect. And then on the second aspect of abolishing or maintaining incentives, we thought that it still falls into the aspect of a pull and push. But what must be done was that we should not rush into publication because it will lead to poor quality. And most often, the few researchers that are able to get funding could not be reproduced. And then there was also the question.
Group eight. Thanks very much. I see that. The throttle is quite fast for everyone. Everyone is assimilated into this discussion, and that is fantastic, really, to see, because this is something that you feel, you touch, you see, and so you can see the passion that comes from discussing these things. Let it not end here, really, because you have raised some fantastic ideas, some fantastic suggestions of improvement. I think those of you who have workshops and seminars related to research, this could be one of the topics you can bring up. Because whatever system we have today was developed and implemented by suggestion of scholars. And it is good in the process of time to always evaluate what we do. Are we doing it rightly? Is that where we are getting it wrong? Are disadvantages greater than the advantages? Can we improve? This is what the human sphere constitutes. You know, it's not the Ten Commandments that is written on the stone. These things can be improved, and the focus will be, how do we ensure that what we are doing gives the right value to the society? If your science, if your research ends up, it is to publish and get my promotion, then you're in a big trouble, honestly, because you'll be remembered as the promotion professor. But I tell you, there are people who are fighting hard to make their voices heard in terms of improving human quality of life and so on and so forth. The project I'm giving to each group, I'm looking forward to Friday, where you begin to dig out some of the things. And what I've done is to intentionally, for each group, highlight the fact that you should compare and see where our continent, Africa, is. And within the African continent, which countries are, in particular indicator, doing better than the others, which countries are doing worse. So it will be an eye-opener for us to understand where we are. And once we have gone through this, it begins to tell us a story of where we should be going as scientists. What am I doing to correct this perspectives, these factors that are impeding development in our continent. So the points you are making are fantastic, but let's take it a step further to now engage in that discussion. The path we are going, does it bring the best from us or out of us? Does it support Africa in the right way? If the answer is no, then we know there's room to improve. So across your research groups, your institutions, let's engage in this discussion. So each group, please, the points you have articulated, I would like to have them. If you don't have them ready today, please, by the end of tomorrow, send them to me, and I will put them in the folder so that everybody can have access to them. Let's continue this discussion. This is academic writing course. What you need to get out of here is a perspective that challenges what you have been doing to make your feet hot, to make a decision. I wouldn't go this path again, or I will refine what I'm doing. I want to go in a better path. That is what I believe you should get out of here. And if you don't get it on Friday, if you tell me I didn't get it, then you know I will stop offering this course because you didn't achieve that. So I want you to get out there and then challenge yourself, challenge your colleagues, challenge the system. There is a way we can do better. And for writing, my writing is to communicate what I'm doing in a clear way that becomes transformational. Okay, let me give you 4 minutes break, stretch your legs. Let's go into another session, 15 past the hour. Okay, let's kick off my people. Time is not our friend at all. Let's see where we can get today. And I hope the groups have created their WhatsApp groups that you meet to discuss your group work. Please start looking at your data, start thinking about it. I think you can already start making effort to analyze. And I hope each group has somebody with some capabilities to do some simple analysis there. All right, if you have any question with regards to the project, please come back to me. Precision, clarity, and brevity. Precision, clarity, and brevity. What we have been doing today, my people, is to set the context. The context of where we are going. That is what we are trying to do today. Then tomorrow we start with the steps. All right. So the goal of scientific writing we have mentioned today is to effectively communicate the results of scientific research and the processes leading to those results. Please meet yourself. So to be able to do this, there is need for construction of coherent texts. That is a necessity. To be able to communicate what you're doing, what you have found, the processes leading to what you have found, you need to have coherence. And some things have been suggested as part of the system of effective communication. One of those is precision. And this is where many, especially the young scientists, the starters, make mistake. Not being precise. You know, going around. And you ask the question, but what are you saying? You have verbose, so much words used. Sometimes you have one concept that requires two words. You are using 10 words just to show you have a dictionary of words. You see, when you come to scientific writing, precision is a quality you should not dribble with. I shouldn't be reading your paper and then I am yawning. I should be reading your paper, my eyes are open to see what is ahead, what was found. So you need to be precise. So you have to say exactly what you mean. For instance, you say, Olajide, for instance, et al. Observed some time ago in an experiment, and they found, and after they found, they suggested that this. You see the words I have used, maybe close to 10 words. That is unnecessary, really. You can as well go to the point and say, Olajide et al. Found. It's the same story. And so don't go about trying to use words, trying to make long sentences. No, just go straight to the point. That is the quality of scientific writing, to be precise. Avoid colloquial expressions, wildcard words that eventually dilute your meaning. And I guess that some of you are already thinking along this line. This is something that concerns you. You know, we in Africa, we like too much noise, really. Oof. Especially in my country, Nigeria. That is why the Nollywood is a hot cake across Africa. People like, because we like too much noise. We make too much noise. But really, when you become a scientist, the noise minimizes and meaning is brought up. What you mean? You are precise. You are direct to the point. That is important. And when you begin to write, you discover that you have limit of what you can do. The journals have number of words. So you don't really have liberty to do whatever you want to do. Sometimes many of us, this journal allows 5,000 words. Yeah, I will take that one. No. Challenge yourself to go to those that require 2,000 words. I have written papers like this, submitted to journals, and they say, well, we can't publish this as a full original article. We'll publish it because it's a new finding. Let's announce it to the scientific community. Please reduce it as a letter to the editor. And I've written it. The journal original article is 3,500 words. It said, please put it maximum of 800 words. You say, what? And then you go back. You sit down. From 3,000 words, you're bringing it to 800 words. That 800 words, we convey the same message as 3,000 words. And if they tell you, bring it to 500 words, you are ready to do it, and it conveys the same message as 800 words and 3,500 words. That is precision. Scientific writing, perception. So you cut off those wild cards that dilute the meaning. Okay? Maybe some of you, your mind is palpating, you have not done this before, but I tell you, I will come to the point where you're motivated on how people have done certain things. Clarity. Clarity is avoiding ambiguity. Clarity is pursuing simplicity. Clarity is pursuing logic, to be logical, to be simple, to avoid ambiguity. Run away from dark, plethoric language that consists of many ideas. Be clear and direct. That is the quality of scientific writing. Preferably use active voice. We found, not it was found. Oof. Already, it was found. It has been suggested. Oof! It has been suggested that the sun rises in the day. You see that? It has been suggested that the sun rises in the day. But you know what? It's the same thing as I would say, the sun rises in the day. Take off that it has been suggested. It only makes your writing so dull. Be direct. Be clear. Use active voice. Follow a logical order. Be cohesive so that your ideas are connected one to the other, you know, and have a pattern that appear. That is why, you see, when I sent you out in the morning, is scientific writing an art or a science? You came back with that. You see, the point we are talking about now is that point where you become artistic, creative, force it. It's something that you tell yourself, I have to do it. You know, this is where they say practice makes perfect. We'll come to that. Brevity, saying only what needs to be said. Avoiding redundancy and wordiness, to be concise, brief to the point. So you're brief to read. This is what I want to say. You see, when the Martin Luther King Jr. made his speech, that has people have bought into. You know how he got there? It took him time in practice. He practiced. I don't have much time. You know, at that time, there were assassinations. People were being killed like animals. African Americans were being killed. And so when you have the opportunity, you go straight to the point. You say what needs to be said and you get out. Oh, no. Now we have no threat. We just enjoy our lives. So we think we have all the time anymore to please meet yourself. Great. Okay. I hope this is resonating with you. If it's not, please let me know. Precision, clarity, brevity. Okay, I'm done with that. This week, I'm going to see all this reflect in your writing. This week, that is why we're here. You know, I was sending out a paper, a manuscript. When I write my manuscript, I always write them. Please, as I'm speaking, take your time to look at what is here. Read what is here. They are very, very important. These are texts written by some authors. Yeah. So I'm sending my papers out for co-authors, and there I usually number it the version. I wrote version 10. Somebody say version 10. What is version 1? That is for me. I use it to relate how much I have gone through that text in version 10, indicating the number of times I have revised it. And you compare my version 10 to my version 1, you begin to see, wow, what a transformation. You need to have that patience to go through it. Habits cultivated and lived by scientists can make or mar their writing success. That is true. What is your habit? The negative ones, very common. Avoidance. No, I don't want to. You begin to procrastinate. No, not time, not now. I don't want to do this now. Okay? Distractions. There are many distractions that are there. Can somebody give us one of the most popular distractions we have nowadays?
Social media,
of course. Even as you're listening to me now, you can see sometimes I hear those noises ringing. If I see all of you, should put on your listen now on your microphone, you will see what happens. Distractions are there so much. Social media. You have not even written 3 words in a sentence. Oh, let me check Facebook. And they are coming in. LinkedIn, they are coming in. Twitter, they are coming in. Then you talk about the physical distractions. Those are distractions that are there. You are not living there, but you are carried away. Distractions that make it impossible for you to focus. Writer's block. When you get to a point where, no, I can't progress. I don't even know what to do. I can't even think. You know, sometimes many people make mistakes by forcing themselves to do it. You have to learn a strategy. When you reach your mental block where you can't progress. Sorry, I wrote block. There is block, sorry. What do you do? For me, I have a strategy. I like nature. I like going to the forest. I like going to the forest. I walk. I can take 1 hour and walk for 6 kilometers. And you know what? I leave it there. By the time I come back, believe in me, things will happen in my head. I go back to that text. It's transformed. Wow. And I've noticed that for a long time, and that is what I do. If I get to a point where I can progress, honestly, I lock it out. Sometimes it may be a few hours. Sometimes it may be a day or two. Sometimes it may be a week, maybe 2 weeks, maybe a month. Then I come back to read. And when I come back to read, the ideas open. So the point I'm making here is that avoidance, don't procrastinate it. Okay? avoid those distractions. These are the negative habits we have cultivated. Perfectionism, where, no, I can't go to the next paragraph. I need to get this one right. I can't move. Let me be here until I get it right. You want to be perfect. No, that is not the way it works. Fear of criticisms. So you don't want to share with your colleagues. You don't want people to criticize you. No, let people break you. Let people break you. You will see the amount of growth that will happen in your life, in your writing. Let them break you. You learn from them. Let them criticize you. Don't be the type of, oh, did you see what he wrote there? Did you see what she wrote there? I remember some years back. It's a long time now, maybe up to 11 years or so. And a friend of mine, I don't know if he will even recognize what he did. Somebody is making noise. If I mute you, you still come up. You want me to take you out? Gladys, can you mute yourself? Goodness me. Gladys, can you mute yourself, please? Thank you. All right. So, this my friend called me. He was studying the US at that time. He called me. He was complaining bitterly. He said, look, Bright, my supervisor, at that time he was doing his master's thesis, my supervisor doesn't like me. And I said, why? What happened? Anytime I send a paper to this woman, she comes back with so much red pen. So much red pain, she writes there. Anytime, there's no time she doesn't make so much red pain and comment. And I laughed. So what do you want? You want blue pen or white pen? So you want, after writing, you just send it to her and she brings it back to you and say, oh, it was all good. No. In fact, you need to thank your supervisor, because it shows that she's given due diligence to read your text. You need criticism. You need people to pull you apart in your writing, and then you organize yourself. Then you see that you are making the right progress. That is the way it works. There's no magic bullet about it. If you try to avoid people, then you'll be in hot water soon. You end up something, even when you have done a fantastic experiment or done a very good study, the aspect of telling your story to the scientific community becomes a problem because you can't do it properly. So allow criticism to come. I didn't say you should begin to take your papers to your husband and wife and say, hey, honey, please just let me read this to you. Yes, you can do that. Okay, but you know that work is work, so that you're not always taking it. But you can use that opportunity to ask your partner or even your child who is of age, say, do you understand what I'm writing here? Those could be your critics. And beyond that, your colleagues. And so collaboration is very important. Collaboration. And that is what you're doing this week. And that is what we want to achieve this week. Reluctance to revise, you don't want to revise. And that is say, you avoid criticism so that you don't revise. Anyway, the positive ones you can take. Define your writing time. Create a working environment that really works. Write first, edit later. Write first, edit later. Don't make everything. Don't think that you can walk through it at the same time. Right, just keep writing. And then you come back and put them. That is how it works. You take this paper, you read, oh, this is so sweet. That is the same process they went through. They write and then they edit, keep editing. Use triggers to develop a productive writing habit. Okay? For instance, some people write when it's snowing. Some people write when it's raining. Some people write when they're angry. Some people write when they're happy. Some people write when they're waking up. Some people write when they want to go to sleep. So you find your own best time that you think triggers you to write. Find it. Everybody has it. Don't be going, you know, hectare, skater, zigzag. You need to find your own time. Be accountable to yourself. Are you improving? Am I improving the goals I have set? Am I getting them? You need to be accountable. Be accountable to yourself. Seek feedback. Think about what you're writing outside of your schedule, writing time. Practice and practice and practice. This is important. Practice, practice, practice. Manage your self-talk about writing. Okay? Self-talk about writing. Reflect with others, manage it. Talk to yourself about your writing. Ask yourself the question, am I doing it well? Reevaluate and move on. So what I have said here, the scariest moment is always just before you start. Okay, the scariest moment. Meaning that when you start, it's not scared anymore. So if you're able to overcome that part, that is not even in the writing itself, then you make a headway. Your desire to write grows with writing. You know, see what people are saying? Your desire. Almost all good writing begins with terrible first efforts. You need to start somewhere. It's powerful. It's powerful. If you're a writer, you will really tie yourself with it because they are saying they don't. My ideas usually come not at my desk writing, but in the midst of living. Whew! That one resonates with me. When I walk through the forest there, it comes. And my phone is my friend. Anyway, I don't say this to him. Those who are close to me, if you take my phone away, then you have really dealt with me. You are in Africa anyway, so your hand can reach here. But what is there is that my phone is my friend. I'm working, then I sit down somewhere and I put those ideas. I put them down. It's good to put them down. Don't say I will write them when I get some. They change those ideas. When this inspiration comes, that time, it's like a prophet who sees. When it comes, say it. And sometimes he says it out or she says it out and they don't even remember what they have said. It comes out. So when the idea comes to you in those times, put them down because the best place to forget is the brain. Write it down. And so I take my phone and I'm sleeping. I wake up in the middle and the idea comes. I put it down. Like those who write songs, it comes. Don't keep it. I will do it. No. That is when you are going to avoidance. Amateurs sit and wait for inspiration. The rest of us just get up and go to work. Okay? Yeah, you see? I'm waiting for it. Don't worry, my time has not come. This place, I need that inspiration. Yes, sometimes it happens. But sometimes it will happen when you start doing it. Then you see it happen. All right, time is flying. Threat of success. Those who have attended the grant writing course, you recognize this. Threat of success, have passion, be persistent, focus, have inner beliefs, be flexible, and network. Don't be afraid to reach out to others. Okay. Critical thinking, ability to reason well. Take action, combining critical analysis with forward momentum. All right, right? Be curious. Be open to failure. Be open to ignorance. I don't know. I don't know. And as a parent, when you have your kids and they're growing, the more they grow, then they begin to know that, oh, so you don't know this really, daddy, mommy. You mean you don't know this? Before they were taking you as their role model, but now they are doing better than you. Yeah, I don't know. Teach me. Of course, where I come from, in my part of the world, said, what you don't know is other than you. And so, learn it. Be patient. Be courageous. Detail-oriented. Be creative. Be communicative. Be open-minded. If you pursue these characteristics, they will turn your world around in your scientific writing. Passion, passion, passion. Asking yourself always, why do you do what you do? Now, I want to tell you, to conclude this habit we are talking about, the power of atomic habits. I want to, when I read this story, wow. I say, wow, this is powerful. This is powerful. I don't know how many of you recognize this. The British cycling history. The story of success revolution. This is what you can apply across many aspects of our lives, whether it's spiritual, whether it's social, whether it's scientific. The power of atomic habit, meaning that, you know, little changes, little improvement, when you put them together, they can become huge improvement, make huge impact. So this is David Braceford. He was recruited in 2003 to be the coach of the British cycling team. For over 100 years before 2003, this team has lived in mediocrity. In the mediocrity, in the sense that they have been unable to win competitions. They just won one gold medal in the Olympic Games in 1908 until 2003, they have not won anything. Their performance was so poor that top bike producers in Europe refused to sell their product to them because it would be a bad image for them. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine that? And then they went and recruited this guy. He was almost unknown. This guy was a thinker. He changed the trajectory. He called it aggregation of marginal gains, searching for tiny margins of improvement in everything you do. Searching for tiny margins. I have written this sentence this way. Can I write it another way? Not, I think it's enough. No, it's not enough. Give that sentence to somebody else. The person transforms it to another thing. In fact, you write one sentence, give it to 100 people, they can write their own the same text in different ways. You can ask yourself, is there another way I can write this? Yes. Perhaps 100 of those ways to write that. Braceford was recruited. And so what he did, he broke down everything, and started improving each of them by 1%. And by the time you put them together, wow. Just hold your peace. I will tell you more what he did. The story is not over. Small improvement that made a big difference. Look at what he did. There are hundreds of them. I just presented some of them here. He redesigned the bike seats for more comfort. Can you imagine that? They have been sitting on this seat. He took it and to the company, I want you to redesign it, put it in another shape. the back seat, saying, oh, where the seat is okay, we don't need to. No, no, no. And he put alcohol on the tires for better grip. You know, the tires there. How did he come with that idea? He took the bike, he took his team members, and he examined them. What can I do to improve this? If you want to be a successful scientific writer, some of you put forth your ideas, my expectations. If you want to get a point you express in the morning, know the power of atomic habits. Electrically heat shorts to maintain ideal temperature. You see, the shorts, you know, we call it the short knicker. Okay, the pants, heat it electrically for more comfort to maintain ideal temperature. Okay, it tested various fabrics, various type of clothing, various of them, to see which ones would give better comfort to the team members. Those who were riding outdoors switched to indoor suits, which are more lighter and more aerodynamic. And they tested different massage gels to see which one gave the quickest muscle recovery. I had a medical doctor to teach the riders the best ways to wash their hands to reduce cold. Can you imagine that? We are all teaching how to wash our hands during the corona. Yeah, even though you teach some people, they still did it the way they want to do it. Yeah. I chose the right pillow, okay, and mattresses to have the best sleep they can ever had. Okay, maybe you are laughing about this. Painted the inside team truck. He painted it the color white to spot any dust so they can be cleaned. Mm-hmm. He did many others. I'll just give you a few. And now, what happened? The results came faster than anybody could think. What happened? 100 years of history was changed. Exactly 100 years. In 5 years after they have started this, the British bike team, cycling team, won 60% of gold medals in the Olympic Games in Beijing 2008. Can you imagine that? They won one in 100 years. Just 5 years of transformation. They won 60 in one tournament, 60%. 4 years after 2008, they set 9 Olympic records and 7 world records. Goodness me, my people. This is, when I read this, I said, wow. So what am I doing? In what I'm doing as a scientist, I have rooms for improvement. Today I have, even as I teach you here, I struggle with my writing, but I've told myself I'm going to improve. You have come to this course. I want you to go back to find a room for improvement. The power of atomic habit. The French tournament, they have 5 victories in 6 years. 5 victories in 6 years, including individual victories. Between 2007 and 2017, they had 178 world championships they have won, 6 Olympic or Paralympic gold medals, and this 5 Tour de France victories. Today, this period of Breffort has been known as the most successful run in cycling history, not of Britain, in the whole world. Yes, that is the story I want to tell you. And that is where I want to end. And I hope that you are catching the virus I'm trying to say to you here. It's virus because it needs to be infectious. What has happened in this story is something we all should yearn for and work towards improving our writing. I hope you're ready for that. Because if you're not ready, then it's difficult. The first place to get success is to work on our habit. What is your writing habit? If you do not have the right habit, we can learn this for 1 year and it doesn't go anywhere. And so, come out of your shell. From tomorrow, come out of your shell. You go to your group, you tell your group, I want to learn. Now I am ready. Throw away all that you have had there. I want to learn. Because by next year, I want to be at this level. Set goals for yourself. I want to be at this level by next year. That is the reason why we have this course. And I'm looking forward to what impact it will have on us. All right. Any question? Any thoughts, please? My talking has finished for today. And I can send you to your groups to brainstorm. Yeah, somebody want to say something? Luca?
Yeah, I Luca from Nigeria, please. Thank you so much for today's session. It's really engaging and very inspiring. My question is that, is it possible for recording of each day be sent to our emails for kind of to go through it before the next day and equally to help us? Because you know some of the slides, there are some points we would like, or personally I would like to pick. So I don't know whether that would be possible, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, so what happens in our trainings, Luca, I think this is your first time.
Yeah.
So every session is recorded. And once it's recorded, you have finished today, it will be downloaded. And once it's downloaded, it's going directly to our YouTube channel. So you should be able to see it tomorrow. I'm not sure of today because you'll be working behind the scene there. And so it can only be downloaded when I put off my Zoom. And then for the slides, once I finish, I'm going to also upload it to the Google Drive. Okay. I'll put it there. So please make sure, as I said in the morning, to make your Google Drive your friend because you can't afford to play with it today and this week.
Okay.
All right. Yeah. Olayinka, please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Dr. Professor Nwaru. Great one. Yeah, you were talking about developing the writing skills, which you said, yes, we should start from, as soon as possible, we should start learning the writing skills. Just little question, like, you know, there are some people whose work lies more on primary data than secondary data. You have to go to the lab, you know, design experiments, whether using rats, mice, and all the rest. You have to get your own primary data before talking about even writing at all. And that's at times is even the bane of some people. So how does one overcome this or, you know, to an extent, incorporate this with the writing skills that you have to develop, you know, as soon as possible?
Well, I think that is an important question. One of the things I mentioned there is patience. You have to know that collecting data can take some time and you have to live with that reality. But collecting data, yeah, it has impact on your writing, but it's a different thing from your writing because you can have the data and you can't write. Okay? So the skill to write should be developed. The skills to write should be developed. The skills to write should be developed. apart from what you're doing in your lab, so that you are ready when the results come, you put them, you know? So it's very important to put that into perspective. Collecting data, regardless of where you're collecting it, if you are collecting it from the lab or from human beings or from companies or from whatever way you're collecting it, you need to have that patience and invest the time that needs to be used to collect it. And then, of course, then you can write. But the writing is a different cup of tea, because if you don't know how to write it, and then the data you have collected will just be in a waste. Okay, I saw Elizabeth. Are you out?
Thank you, Prof. Bright. Mine is just a small observation on the scientific writing. I'm trying to ask if there is any writing plan like what we see in other steps in the science writing. So I just wanted to know if there is that, and if possible, then if it can be shared by any written document that can help in writing process.
What do you mean by plan? What do you mean by plan?
Like, for example, when you are doing the analysis, you might have an analysis plan that mm-hmm. one can see how you go through.
Yeah. So that is what, if you look at the outline of this week, that is what we will start from tomorrow.
Thank you, Prof.
Okay, right. So tomorrow we will start the journey.
Okay.
Elizabeth, you're already thinking ahead of us. Just be with us at the level we are. Tomorrow we'll get.
All right. Okay. Thanks, Prof.
All right. Any other person? Any other question? All right. So I will put you to your groups now. And of course, our time for the classroom work is up now. So discuss with your group. I'll be around here. Those who fall out from the group because of network, I'll be here to put you into your groups. So please discuss your questions for your group that you're going to answer this week. It's good to start working on that now, thinking about it. And then tomorrow we'll meet again. Group one, you're presenting your nugget number one tomorrow when we start. Group two, prepare yours. Group three, prepare yours. Group four, prepare yours. In fact, all the groups need to think. So you just pick that paper and read it. And then we'll kick it there. Okay, let me open this.